Hello everyone, a very good morning. I'm Dr. Chetan Rao, consultant pulmonologist at Yashoda Hospital, Somajiguda. So today I'll be discussing a few points on bronchoscopy in this COVID-19 era. So yeah, coming to a bronchoscope is nothing but a tube which has a camera, a light source and a working channel at its tip. So we use this tube to assess the patient's airways and lungs. So basically it is a long tube which is either passed from the mouth or nose into the lungs. On the way we assess the airways and also the lungs and decide what to do. So you must have been hearing about endoscope. Just like an endoscope is for the stomach, a bronchoscope is for the lungs. So bronchoscope is used for two purposes. One, we divided it as like a diagnostic bronchoscope, where we use the bronchoscope to diagnose ailments in a patient, like to identify a problem. And the other section is a therapeutic bronchoscopy, where we use the bronchoscope to treat a specific condition. And there are also special techniques of bronchoscope, like endobronchial ultrasound, bronchial thermoplasty, bronchoscopic lung volume reduction, which are having very specific limited indications. They again come under therapeutic bronchoscopy. Coming to a bronchoscope, again, there are two types of bronchoscope which we use in day-out practice. One is a flexible bronchoscope and a rigid bronchoscope. So mostly for the diagnostic purposes, we use a flexible bronchoscope, which is like flexible. And for the therapeutic purposes, more or less, we use a rigid bronchoscope. So diagnostic purposes, like any patient who comes to us with chronic cough. So to evaluate cough, we might use a bronchoscope. Any patient who comes with a history of lung infection where you don't find a cause on normal investigations, so then we go into the lungs, collect secretions from the lungs and send that for further analysis to decide on what infection is this. It can be a normal community acquired pneumonia. Sometimes we use it for diagnosing tuberculosis also. So these are some indications of diagnostic bronchoscopy, and also sometimes a patient comes with noisy breathing. So that we call in medical terms as stridor. This is one specific indication for a diagnostic bronchoscopy, where we go inside and assess the airways if there is any blockage inside that is making a noisy breathing happen. So, and coming to the therapeutic bronchoscopy, where we use bronchoscopy as a treatment modality. Like a patient comes with a patch in his lungs, which we call collapse, that might be because of a mucus plug obstructing the airways. So in such cases, we put in a bronchoscope, aspirate the mucus plug, allow the air to pass into the lung so that the lung opens. This is one therapeutic indication. And some people, especially a pediatric age group and elderly age group, they come with foreign body aspirations. That is, they put something in the mouth which is accidentally aspirated into the lungs, be it some peanuts, tamarind seeds, some organic plastic materials or so. We see that commonly. So we put in a bronchoscope and we use various other equipments to retrieve this foreign body out. This is another therapeutic indication. And one more other indication is airway tumors and airway stenosis. We see more of people coming with airway tumors and stenosis. Stenosis is nothing but a constriction in the airways. So this is one indication where we use a bronchoscopy to treat the patient. Like we decannulate, we debulk the tumor, and then for the stenosis, we either dilate the stenosis or put stents, tracheal stents, airway stents. So these are some therapeutic indications. And there are other modalities of therapeutic bronchoscopy, like bronchial thermoplasty, which we are doing, and that is used for chronic asthmatic patients who are not responding to the regular medical treatment. So these are some indications which we divide into diagnostic or therapeutic bronchoscopies. Coming to the bronchoscopy in this COVID era, it is definitely different from a normal time. So now we have come down on the indications, or we have narrowed to some specific indications where to do a bronchoscopy. Because doing a bronchoscopy in this COVID era is definitely risky. May not be for the patient, but at least for the healthcare professionals, because bronchoscopy is an aerosol generating procedure. And definitely aerosols are more effective than a droplet or fomite. So that is the reason we are taking utmost precautions to do a bronchoscopy. So first of all, whether to do a bronchoscopy or not in a particular patient who is coming to us. We are analyzing the risk and benefit. So calculating the risk-benefit ratio, only if the benefit is more than the risk, we go ahead with a bronchoscopy in this COVID-19 era. So first of all, we divide if it is a suspect of COVID-19 or a proven case of COVID-19 or totally a different cause or indication for bronchoscopy. If the patient who is coming to us has an indication which is totally different from COVID-19, or the patient is proven to be negative of COVID-19, or there are some other indications which require emergency management, then we take them in straight away. Like I said, you tumors, airway tumors and airway foreign bodies, airway stenosis. These are some of the emergency conditions where we have to do a bronchoscopy at any cost to save the life. And then comes to semi-urgent, semi-emergent procedures. Here, we properly take a history of the patient. If there is no history of travel, if there is no history of contact with a positive case, or if the patient is not from a hotspot or containment area, and the radiology is not supportive of COVID-19, that is your CT or the patient's X-ray is not supportive of COVID-19, then we take all the precautions. As a healthcare personnel, we are supposed to do a bronchoscopy in a complete PPE where we wear all the surgical gowns, N95 masks, shields and everything, so that we minimize our exposure to the aerosols. And that is how we are dealing with bronchoscopies in this COVID-19 era in a semi-urgent or semi-emergency cases. And coming to elective cases, we try to postpone them if it is not necessarily required. That again, we do on a case-to-case basis and weigh the risk over the benefit and take a call. Before doing the bronchoscopy, for sure, we evaluate the patient properly with the history, radiology, and only if the COVID-19 is ruled out, we take. Coming to bronchoscopy in suspects of COVID-19 or a proven case of COVID-19. So as per all the guidelines, bronchoscopy in a COVID-19 has to be avoided as much as possible until unless it is a dire emergency or otherwise necessary. So bronchoscopy in COVID-19 is a relative contraindication. So that again has to be on a case-to-basis. If a patient is COVID-19 positive on a ventilator, and if you say the patient's airways are filled with mucus plugs, then that is an indication we have to go and clear the mucus plug so that the ventilatory support is reaching the lungs and the patient improves. And sometimes we see patients on ventilators with airway bleeds. That is another indication where we have to go in for sure to see what exactly is happening inside. So there are some very specific indications even in a case of COVID-19 where we have to do a bronchoscopy. And all that is done as per the guidelines, ideally in a negative pressure room, and the healthcare professional inside the room are limited to decrease the exposure. Everyone is in a proper PPE, and in a COVID-19 patient, ideally the bronchoscopy is to be done under general anesthesia, so that under general anesthesia and paralysis, so that the patient is not coughing and we are minimizing the aerosol production. So coming to the precautions a patient is supposed to take for bronchoscopy, I would say no major precautions, because most of the times it is a very simple daycare procedure which we do. But there are some aspects which a patient has to look in. First thing, if you are on any blood thinners, like most of the patients who have cardiac issues or who has a stent in the heart or have undergone a bypass surgery are usually kept on blood thinners. So in such cases, if we are doing a biopsy in a bronchoscopy, then we are already tell the patients to withhold their blood thinning medicines. Depending on what medicine it is, we give a specific time. For those days, the patient has to not to take that blood thinner medicines, because when we do a biopsy, there is an increased chance of bleeding. This is one precaution patient has to take. Second thing, we ask the patient to come nil by mouth. At least 6 to 8 hours of fasting is necessary for a bronchoscopy. So if you are, say, doing a bronchoscopy, we give the patient a fixed appointment or a slot, and we ask them to come fasting prior 6 to 8 hours, not even water and no solids, nothing, nil by mouth. These are the two major precautions a patient has to take before bronchoscopy. And bronchoscopy is usually done under conscious sedation, or if it is a therapeutic procedure, or if you are anticipating a longer time, we might give a short general anesthesia. So always the patient has to be accompanied by an attender, because post procedure a patient will still have some amount of sedation and he is not fit to go by himself anywhere. That is the reason he has to have an attender with him. These are the few main precautions a patient has to take. So if a patient is posted for a bronchoscopy, before the bronchoscopy we do preparation for bronchoscopy. So the patient has to change into the hospital gowns so that this to prevent infections, and there are certain policies which vary from hospital to hospital. Some institutions prefer giving a local anesthetic nebulization before the procedure. Some just do a local anesthetic spray and go in. So that again varies from institution to institution. If you are being given a local anesthetic nebulization, this is nursing staff from the bronchoscopy department will give you a nebulization for some 10 to 15 minutes of a local anesthetic and a bronchodilator so that your airways become numb. That will help you getting a bronchoscopy done smoothly. Otherwise, you'll be having some pain or discomfort while the procedure. And after that, we'll be taking a consent. We'll counsel you along with and also your attender about what actually we are doing. Is it a diagnostic procedure or are we doing any other interventions along with? We'll also explain all the possible complications, side effects of the procedure even before doing the procedure. After that, we obtain a written and informed consent. If the patient and the attender both are willing for whatever things explained, we take the patient in. After taking the patient onto the table, what we do is we spray a local anesthetic into the throat so that the throat also becomes numb. And we might instill a local anesthetic jelly into your nostrils if we are passing a scope through the nose. So these are the preparation done before the bronchoscopy, and just before starting the bronchoscopy, we might give you an injection, IV sedative, so that you feel comfortable while we do the procedure. If it is done under conscious sedation, which usually happens in most of the cases, you will be aware of what is happening to you, but just that you will perceive less pain. But definitely there will be some irritation. If we are doing it under general anesthesia, you will not be knowing anything. But again, the preparation for general anesthesia is totally different. The anesthetic team will take a look of you before the procedure. Only when the anesthesia people give you will clear you for the bronchoscopy, we'll plan you for a bronchoscopy. And during general anesthesia, you will absolutely have no idea of what is happening. You'll be out of anesthesia only after the procedure is done. Coming to the post procedure, you will be having some amount of cough, which is more than the baseline, because we have put a tube inside and we might have taken some biopsies from inside, we might have taken some secretions. All this will actually irritate your airways. So that is the reason you will be having some amount of cough post procedure. And sometimes if we do a biopsy of a lung, or if you have done a biopsy from the tumor, there might be some bleeding that have happened inside the airways. So when you cough out, you might be seeing streaks of blood in your sputum for a day or so, which you should not panic about, because that is quite normal. It is all the already which is blood inside will come out. Otherwise, most of the cases we don't see any active major bleeding happening post procedure. And we also tell the patient and the attenders that you might be having a chance having fever for the coming 24 hours period post bronchoscopy, and you might have to take your consultant's opinion if the fever persists even after 24 hours, or you have a fresh bout of bleeding happening, or any other unanticipated complications. And of course, you have to have an attender to accompany you home post procedure. So most of the times we do a daycare procedure, until unless it is a very emergency procedure, or the patient comes to us in a very critical state, like in overt respiratory failure or an unconscious state where we have to do emergency tracheostomies or emergency stentings and all that. In such cases, we might have to keep you in the hospital for a day or two. Only then we'll take a call on sending you home. If we place a stent, we'll also teach you and your attendant all the possible care and all the precautions to be taken to keep the stent healthy. These are some of the things which we do, and then we plan a discharge. As already discussed, most of the times diagnostic bronchoscopies are day care. So we ask the patient to come on the same day fasting and we do the procedure. Diagnostic bronchoscopies usually take 10 to 15 minutes, not more than that. We do it under conscious sedation, and post procedure we'll keep you under observation for 2 to 3 hours because we have sprayed a local anesthetic, we have given you local anesthesia while going in. So your airways are numb. You will not be able to swallow anything during that period of time. And for the 2 to 3 hours post-procedure also, we'll not be giving you anything through mouth. All through the while, pre-procedure, during the procedure, post-procedure, you'll be on fluids, which will take care of your general health. So after that, we'll assess you. After the procedure, if you're not having any major bleeding, if you're not having any severe cough, and if you're maintaining oxygen saturation levels on room air, you'll be fit for discharge, which happens in 90% of the cases. Only when we plan a therapeutic procedure or a diagnostic procedure in a high-risk patient, like a person who has already an existing lung disease or a severe heart disease or any other severe comorbidities, that is the case when we ask the patient to be in the hospital for observation at least for a day post-procedure. That again, we assess the risk and benefit after the procedure. If we think the patient is absolutely fine after the procedure, we might send him back the same day. Or if the patient is requiring some mild oxygen support or some injections to control his bleeding or anything of such kind, we'll admit the patient in the hospital. There's one more therapeutic indication which I already discussed, like bronchial thermoplasty, where we do a procedure in a patient. This is a treatment modality for patients who are having severe asthma and not responding to medical treatment. In such cases, we anticipate some exacerbation of bronchial asthma post-procedure. So ideally, we ask them to stay back with us for a day, and once everything settles down, we discharge them. So usually it is a day or more or less 2 days, but not more than that. That too only in high-risk cases and some specific indications. Otherwise, most of the times, 90% it is a daycare procedure. The patient comes in, gets it done, and goes on the same day. So I thank you all for your patient listening, and we are always there here to help you. If you have any respiratory symptoms, please call us. We are always available online, also on phone consultations. And coming to the bronchoscopy, if any other consultant has advised you, please approach us. We'll take a call and decide if it is an emergency procedure or if it can be postponed for some time in this COVID-19 era. And then on the basis of risk-benefit ratio, we'll take a call and do a bronchoscopy. You don't have to panic about that. And meanwhile, everyone, please follow the social distancing, follow cough etiquette, stay home, stay safe. Thank you.